Hello and welcome to our program with Professor Edward Westerman about his recent book, Drunk on Genocide. My name is Thorin Trutter. I'm the Museum and Programming Director at the Holocaust Memorial and Tolerance Center of Nassau County, which is located in Glen Cove, New York. Before we get to tonight's program and before we get to Professor Westerman, I want to let you know about some of our other upcoming programs. Just put in a little advertisement for these. Tomorrow at 7 p.m., I hope you'll join us for a presentation from an award-winning science journalist, Melinda Wenner-Moyer, who's going to draw from a book that she just published to talk about how to raise children who are not racist. And she's going to share a whole wealth of social science research that's been done about this. And I hope it'll be an interesting program. I'm sure it'll be an interesting program. I hope you'll join us. Then on Wednesday at 11 a.m., I'll be back to hold the next of my Curator's Corner. I'm going to focus on the Feldafing Displaced Persons Camp and a photograph that shows a theatrical troupe doing a performance in 1947 at that DP camp. And then August 25th, I'll be back again on Wednesday at 11 to talk about the liberation of Paris that happened on August 25th, 1944. So that anniversary, I'll be talking about the liberation of Paris. You can find more information about these programs and all our programs on our website at www.hmtcli.org, and then click on the events tab. Okay, enough advertisements. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. And I am delighted, really, and honored to have with us this evening Professor Edward Westerman, the Regents Professor of History at Texas A&M University San Antonio, to hear about his recent book, Drunk on Genocide, Alcohol and Mass Murder in Nazi Germany. We had actually originally scheduled to hold this program back in May, but faced some technical problems and so had to postpone. And I'm really glad, very glad, that Professor Westerman was able to reschedule this presentation. So thanks for coming back. The book has been receiving a lot of attention since its publication. I saw one comment from Thomas Kuhn, the chair of the Strasser Center of Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Clark University, that I found powerful. He wrote that this book is a must read to understand how ordinary men could become mass murderers. And that question about how just ordinary people could not only decide to support the Nazis, but become active in being perpetrators and to murder Jews in the most horrible ways, that's a question that I'm always struggling with. And Professor Westerman helps us explore that question in this book. Let me back up and just say that this book follows on the heels of four other books, authored or co-authored by Professor Westerman about the Holocaust, including his 2005 book, Hitler's Police Battalions, and his 2016 book, Ostkrieg and the Indian Wars, Comparing Genocide and Conquest. Professor Westerman has also published numerous essays and journal articles about the Holocaust and about military history, and serves as a commissioner on the Texas Holocaust and Genocide Commission. I won't run through all of Professor Westerman's awards and fellowships, but I trust you realize that we have with us this evening really a recognized Holocaust scholar who's going to give us some information about this research, the new research that he's been doing. One more comment before I stop talking, and that is just to encourage all of you out there, if questions come up, please use the Q&A function of Zoom and type in your questions, and Professor Westerman will make sure to make time at the end of his presentation to look at those questions and respond. So if you've got them as they come up, just type them in and we'll get to them at the end of the program. Okay, so with that layout of the evening, I'm delighted to welcome Professor Edward Westerman.
Thank you so much, Thorin, and I would like to say I'm delighted to be back. I don't know how many of the individuals that are here tonight were actually at the earlier one where I kept losing my internet connection, but I wanna say if you did come back, thank you very much for doing that, and I'm glad we have the opportunity to try this again. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen, and I'm gonna go ahead and work on that presentation that I had prepared for you all a couple of months ago. As I was looking at this book, and as I do this presentation, thinking about the role of alcohol. The picture that you see right now on your screen is Police Battalion 101. And this was the police battalion that was kind of made notorious, if you will, in Chris Browning's book, Ordinary Men. And these are men in 1940, they're outside the Łódź ghetto, and they're celebrating Christmas. And as you can see, they're drinking and celebrating, which seems pretty mundane. I mean, most of us celebrate a holiday, might raise a glass or two. But this is also a picture from that same Christmas celebration. And I think it gives us a different perspective on thinking about that celebratory ritual. And if you look at this picture, what you see is a skit that was included for the policeman. And you have the policeman and they're gathered around another policeman who's been dressed kind of as a parody of an Orthodox Jew holding a basket. And this policeman represents the duty that they've been conducting for the last months outside the Łódź ghetto, which is interdicting smugglers into the ghetto. And in fact, what we know from the historical record is they've made a comprehensive use, regular use of their weapons in doing that and have killed a number of Jews involved in smuggling. So when you see this picture, the idea that that is something that they would want to incorporate as kind of a skit to make fun of that, I think is really telling into the way that they're thinking about their duties and how they're kind of celebrating, if you will, what they're involved in. And I'll obviously talk more about this as we go through. But for me, as I was starting this project about 6 years ago and thinking about how alcohol was used by the perpetrators, really the first question that I had in developing what became the book was, what role did alcohol play and how were drinking rituals used by the perpetrators themselves? And in fact, in the literature, there's a great deal of discussion where you see alcohol is mentioned, but not really theorized or really discussed in great detail. And then what became very clear to me as well, as I kind of continued along the path of thinking about the topic, is it's just not literal intoxication that we're seeing in the case of the Nazis, especially in the case of the East, the occupied Eastern territories. There's a metaphorical intoxication of control over other peoples. And I'll talk about how that's manifested, but these two work together often in consonance. And then as I continue to develop the idea for the book, it became clear to me that masculinity and perceptions of masculinity within these police and SS units and the Wehrmacht also played a critical role in how they thought about things like camaraderie, like drinking, like sexuality, and what that then meant for the things that they became involved in the East, acts of sexual and physical violence. And then finally, I think one of the key takeaways from this research is, does, as Thorin was talking about earlier, what insights do we gain on perpetrator motivation? What can we see from how alcohol is used? What can we actually derive about the nature of the mindset of those involved? So that's quite a lot to do. And one of the things that became really apparent to me as I began this, as a historian, we can look at the sources and look at the historiography related to this. But when we get into the minds of the perpetrators and start to think about psychological disposition, when we start to think about social actions, it became really clear to me that I needed to expand this into social sciences. And quite frankly, one of the good things about doing that is that criminology and psychology and sociology actually have a pretty developed literature related to alcohol use, the role of alcohol in aggression, for example, alcohol in gang violence, alcohol in teams, in team usage of alcohol, so camaraderie. So I was really able to kind of embark upon this by leveraging a lot of good social science literature, which I think actually enhances our understanding of the use of alcohol under the Third Reich. And another thing that was really important is the social and cultural placement of alcohol. As certainly the viewers know, not every society uses alcohol. Some societies use beer or wine or distilled liquors, and the way it's used and when it's used is different. So one of the key things is being able to place alcohol use within German society itself. In lines with that, another area that has a pretty substantial literature related to alcohol involves medical studies and physiological effects. And I might have a little time to get into that as we go forward. And then finally, understanding the roles and functions of alcohol. And I'll talk more about that later. Now, as I said a little bit earlier, that masculinity is a kind of key portion of this book and how I look at how alcohol is used. And for those who are not really familiar with this literature, it's important to understand that masculinity is kind of defined in opposition to what it's not, femininity, right? And if we look at the literature of masculinity, many use this term hegemonic masculinity. So what's the dominant standard, the kind of socially constructed standard of what it means to be a man in a given place in a given time? So hegemonic masculinity gets talked about quite a bit. In my book, actually, I refer to hypermasculinity. And in Nazi Germany, I think what distinguishes this masculine ideal, if you will, is it's very much a militarized masculinity. Soldier ethos, martial thinking is very much a critical component of how men idolize themselves or view others. And if we look at the Third Reich, it's not really singers or actors who are the celebrities of the Third Reich, especially during World War II. It's going to be the heroes, if you will, the military heroes. And that's one manifestation of this militarized masculinity. It's also manifested in how you're supposed to act, how tough you're supposed to be. And a second part of masculinity I think is important for thinking about the Third Reich is acts of performative masculinity. So competing against other men to be better than they are. And that could be in the bar room by how much you can drink. It could be in the killing field by how many you kill. And so I'll talk about that in more depth. But I think I wanted definitely to give you a definition here of the way in which I'm using masculinity to help you kind of think about the way it frames the book. And so as you see this idea of militarized masculinity within this patriarchal racial hierarchy, and then you have this idea of gender roles, sexuality, racism, and the role of racial war, this kind of all comes together to create this kind of ideal type. Now, if we were to look at the relationship of masculinity and alcohol, we could certainly talk about 20th century U.S. or even 21st century U.S. culture. And what we see in some of the literature that I was talking about earlier from the social sciences is that there is very much this belief that your ability to hold your liquor, so your ability to continue to act, perform, not pass out, and how much you can drink is a marker of masculinity for many at different points and different times in U.S. culture as well. And what we also see that your ability to hold that liquor is equated with greater masculinity. Now, if we go back to Nazi Germany in the 1930s, this is exactly one of the things that the Nazi leader of the Eastern Ministries, Alfred Rosenbergen, who became kind of the Nazi, if you will, philosopher in quotation marks, he remarked about this critically, that the idea was in Germany in the 1930s, this highest manifestation of masculinity was your ability to drink everyone else under the table. And he was arguing against that. He said, we need to change that. And as I'll show in this presentation, he was not very successful in being able to do that. So there's a recognition here that that is kind of the standard. And the other thing that's important as we look at social science literature, I think, to understand is that this very close connection between alcohol, perceptions of masculinity, and aggression, both physical and physical abuse and sexual aggression that take place as a result of drinking. And so we see that in the literature. And we also see this idea of performative masculinity that then kind of crosses over into terms of how men perform against each other, but how they also perform for recognition amongst the opposite sex. And that often leads to acts of sexual violence. And in the case of university fraternities, it's Peggy Sande's work here in this case, Fraternity Gang Rape, looks at how members of that organization established camaraderie. And one of the ways they did that was through heavy drinking, which anybody familiar with fraternity culture would be would recognize. But that it's also sexual violence was often a group dynamic was involved, and it created a way in which male bonding was established amongst the perpetrators of that violence. And the reason I'm bringing this up is we'll see the same dynamic in the East among SS and police units. And we'll also see this dynamic with respect to the allegiance to the acts of violence themselves, not just sexual, but physical violence. And as I talked earlier, one of the things that I looked at was the various roles and functions of alcohol. And certainly the first one for many of us, if you're a drinker or you enjoy a social drink, the idea of social bonding, of celebration, birthdays, anniversaries, holidays, whatever the case might be, we're familiar with that, getting a promotion, celebrating. And rituals that are involved with drinking, and that can be the place at which you drink, where you go to drink, what's consumed and how it's consumed. Here I have competitions. If I talk to my students in university, the idea of beer pong, some of you might be familiar with, the idea that, you know, can you play the game better than the other person and still drink and still be able to function? We see these kinds of manifestations of competitions also under National Socialism that I'll refer to a little bit later. As I've already mentioned, this idea, this intersection between alcohol and masculinity, physical and sexual violence, we'll look at that. And selective disinhibition is a technical term, but this is where I tell my students, this is what I call the so-called spring break effect. In other words, that people will do things after drinking that they would not otherwise have done. So jumping into the hotel pool from your second or third floor balcony at 3 a.m. in the morning is only a good idea because you've been drinking so heavily. That's not something you would do necessarily if you hadn't been. And in the East, we see selective disinhibition happens in some cases with respect to the murder of either women or children, that there are those individuals who need alcohol to disinhibit themselves from some of those acts. Probably the most interesting thing in my mind that the research discovers with respect to functions of alcohol is facilitation. And this is where alcohol and drinking facilitates further acts of violence. So those who are involved in a celebratory environment are drinking, they then decide that they want to go commit other acts of transgression. And I have some examples I'll look at on that. Incentive and reward. One of the things that's important to remember is that alcohol is a luxury good in the East, and in fact, in Germany during World War II. And it's used to incentivize and reward those who participate. And then finally, coping. And the reason I put coping last is because probably it's the thing that most who are familiar with the arguments and historiography would refer to first, that the killers could only do what they did by drinking. So, and afterwards they needed alcohol to cope with what they've done. And although that's true, I think at the end of this presentation, you'll see that I'm attempting to complicate that a little bit more because while coping exists, I think you'll see that there's quite a few other functions of alcohol in the East. In looking at the book, I've just provided here, these are the chapters to give you an idea of what's in the book. And one of the things I'm going to focus on actually tonight is the celebrating murder. So the chapter five. And I have a quote here from Omer Bartov's Anatomy of Genocide. So he's dealing with this community in Buchach in Ukraine. And in the book that he writes, he talks about the removal of Jews as part of a day's work, as quote, entertainment, as background noise to drinking bouts or amorous relationships. And he goes on to say that, in fact, that this type of activity is rarely reflected in the historiography and in the post-war testimony. Now, I think Omer's right. It's not really reflected that much in the historiography. But actually, as you look at the sources, there's a great deal of information related to this. And this is kind of one of the things that I focus on in the book to try to place how these activities take place, especially the celebratory nature of some of these activities. I think it's important to understand that these type of activities, this type of masculine camaraderie that I'm talking about, doesn't exist just with the start of the Third Reich. In fact, it's intrinsic to the Nazi paramilitary groups, the stormtroopers, the SA, and later on the SS, and later on these police units. So we see this even before the Nazis come to power. And we see in the sites, these so-called SA pubs, or these SA homes, where these men gather together, these SA, these stormtroopers gather together. And often it's to drink, but it's really about shared camaraderie. It's about political mobilization. It's about song and the nature of song and music that's used. And one of the most interesting manifestations of this research for me was how important song and music became to the perpetrators in many different ways. And then finally, how these areas, these pubs, are used as sites to incentivize, to kind of launch political violence against enemies before Hitler actually comes to power. So in the 1920s and early 1930s. And I've got a couple of quotes here. And I think the first quote here, the power of music in mobilizing groups in reaching to kind of these visceral reactions that groups have, I think is really important to understand. And I think, you know, many of us have been to concerts, and there are concerts that have that same effect. Some people have been to religious revivals, and they work on the same type of emotive, visceral kind of reaction. And certainly contemporaries understood that and saw how important that was. And then this drinking, this emotional camaraderie that Christopher Dillon in his excellent book talks about, it results in now physical aggression against enemies. And so as we were thinking about that social science literature that I was talking about earlier, we see how that manifestation of drinking leads to physical violence. Now, tying alcohol to German culture, beer in Germany has been referred to as liquid bread. It's more of a foodstuff than an inebriant. And that's certainly true to a certain extent. But paradoxically, you have about 300,000 estimated alcoholics in Germany in 1939. And to be labeled a chronic alcoholic in Nazi Germany was not without extreme risk for those who received that, because it meant things like imprisonment, it meant things like being sent to concentration camps. And because of the law for the prevention of hereditarily diseased progeny, it also means forced sterilization. So one historian has estimated that at least 30,000 Germans were sterilized based on the diagnosis of chronic alcoholism. And in the way that the SS saw its use of alcohol, Heinrich Himmler, as head of the SS, understood that alcohol could be something that could bring the men together. And so what he envisioned for the SS is that these men, after being involved in difficult circumstances, in being involved in mass murder or being involved in camp duty, that they could get together, they could bond, they could literally read poetry, sing songs, drink a half liter or a liter of beer, and he kind of cut it off there. And it would serve to allow these men to kind of decompress from the so-called hard duties they were involved in. And this is the way that Himmler envisions alcohol use amongst the troops and amongst his SS and policemen. But as we'll see in the examples I have, this is not the way alcohol was used by most of those men. And in fact, when we start looking at where we see manifestations of alcohol use tied to violence, the first place we see that is in the concentration camps prior to World War II. So these concentration camps become, in Donald Bloxham's word, kind of zones of exception, just like the occupied East will be a zone of exception. And if you see the listing of the things that I talk about that happen in the camp, rituals of humiliation, violence and amusement, competition, murder games, what we're seeing here is not just the intoxication, these actions resulting from literal intoxication, but from the metaphorical intoxication of those SS personnel over in their control over those inferior, quote unquote, individuals, over those putative enemies that are confined in the concentration camps. And the quote that you see below is from a witness testimony, and it kind of summarizes here again the idea of amusement taken and control over the bodies of others, and the dehumanization comes out in this, and the enjoyment, if you will, the laughing of the perpetrators. And one of the striking things in looking at this research is how often witnesses remember in their debasement, they remember the laughter that surrounds that. I think that's really an important, again, it's an important thing to think about as to what it tells us about mindset amongst the perpetrators. And things like murder games, where you have, I have some later examples, but one of the most notorious was taking a prisoner's cap, an SS guard taking it and throwing it away from the group, and then ordering the prisoner to go pick that cap up. And then the prisoner would be shot while trying to escape. And what that meant for the guard might mean some extra free time. It might mean the opportunity, some vacation days, lighter duties. But the integration of different types of games that I'll talk about as I move forward in the discussion here. Here, Rudolf Höss, the notorious commandant at Auschwitz, himself talks about physical violence as a kind of entertainment. This slide for me is an interesting slide because it gets to this concept of facilitation that I talked about in alcohol use. And in the ghetto here, what you'll probably notice is the survivor, the witness, is talking about what she saw, and these Gestapo men coming in to the ghetto drunken and killing people, quote, as a sport. But I would direct your idea, your attention, if you will, to when this takes place. So this happens on New Year's Eve of 1942. So what has taken place is these Gestapo men have been celebrating, and they're going to bring in the New Year. So they've been drinking. And what's the first thing they want to do to bring in the New Year? They want to go into the ghetto, and they want to kill Jews. And I think that, again, this is the kind of example that really gives us an insight into how these particular men viewed their duties. So they're not sitting in the bar with their heads hanging down, passed out into their beer glasses. They're thinking about these acts of violence and continuing them into the next year as they start that year. And in the book, I have numerous examples of this, where you also see how the idea of hunting, which is a very much a masculinely encoded activity, how many survivors or witnesses talk about Germans hunting Jews or Slavs or other groups, and the way they would do this. And you get again another insight into the way in which violence is used by the perpetrators. And this doesn't necessarily always have to include alcohol. It can in some cases, but it also occurs without that, that kind of metaphorical intoxication, the power over life and death. This slide for me is another one of those that in looking at it, you probably the first thing that you would notice is the left lower left-hand picture, and you see a Star of David. This is the police bar for Police Battalion 61 located outside the Warsaw Ghetto, and they've decorated their bar. And in a very cynical way, they've decorated it with a Star of David at the bar. And if we were standing at that bar, we would not only see that fixture, that light fixture that's been established there, but we would turn around and what we would see is murals hand-drawn by the men of the police battalion on the wall depicting their duties in the ghetto, in which heavily caricatured Jews and the policemen themselves are pictured. In one case, there's a Jewish man who's reaching down to pick up a potato from the ground, and there's a policeman behind him with his rifle leveled. He's going to shoot him for being involved in smuggling, for taking food that's not his. And if you think about these men who are sitting in that bar, this is the environment that they're celebrating in. And another thing that if we were there at this time, the first thing we would have noticed as we went into that bar was there was a wooden door. And in groups of five, there were lines drawn on the door. And eventually there were 500 of those notches drawn into the door. And each one of those represented someone that the unit had killed. So a tally board, the competition amongst the members, that's what they valued, right? Again, giving us an idea into their mindset. Another thing that in looking at this topic, which really surprised me as I kind of went into it, was the instances in which not only alcohol is used at the killing sites, but in some cases in which women are allowed to either be witnesses or even in some cases participate in these acts. The inclusion of song and music, but eating. And if one thinks about that, to think about going to the killing site, going to the killing pit, murdering individuals, being covered with the body matter of your victims, and then walking back 25 or 50 meters to a table set with food and sitting down and taking a break and eating and drinking. The physiological barrier that is overcome in doing that and what that tells us about those men who are involved in these actions. And performative masculinity in the case of performing for women. And one particularly kind of, in my mind, horrific example of that involves a policeman who comes back from a killing action. And the first place he goes, his uniform's dirty from the body matter and blood of his victims. But he goes up to see the secretary in the administrative office first, because he wants to show her how strong he is, how tough he was. And his idea in his mind is that this will impress her with his kind of, if you will, toughness or hardness. And we see this kind of festive, if you will, incorporation of some of these aspects of murder to include music. And again, here I'm using, this was an interrogation protocol where you have someone saying it was just like a carnival, just like a Volksfest, to have that music playing as one of the members remember. And certainly sexual violence is part and parcel of many of these acts. Here I'm talking about security service men. And as you'll see, they've been drinking as they're involved in this action. But one of the things they're focusing on is the humiliation and the sexual battery of women, in this case with dog whips. We also If we look at Auschwitz as an example, Ruth Elias, in her book and in her testimony, her recorded testimony, she talks about being in Block 6, which also housed the Mel Camp Orchestra in Birkenau. And she remembers how drunken SS men would come at night to Block 6. And the reason they came in there, there was a number of young girls there, and they were coming there to assault those women. But the first thing that they would do as they broke in to that, went into those barracks, was they would wake up the orchestra and they would tell the orchestra to start playing music. And then they would go after the girls, as Ruth Elias remembers. And to think about that, and she had this phrase in her testimony, quote, the music had to play. And to think about the staging of these acts of sexual violence by these drunken men with the music needing to accompany it, I think, again, gives us some insight into the minds of these perpetrators. And as I talked about earlier, this idea of the use of games and the horrific example on the top, this is kind of a drinking game in which children are the props to the drinking game. And if you think about this game, it's not only about murder. It's about demonstrating the strength of the individual, the aim of the individual, as horrendous as that sounds, and their ability to accomplish the killing of children. And then if they do it right, they get something to drink. This again reframes that using that use of alcohol by these perpetrators, certainly. And there are other examples here. I want to kind of move forward a little bit because I definitely want to give have time for discussion here. So celebrating murder with whole numbers. And one of the things that that is very clear from the interrogation testimony is that men remember others who kept count and competed with each other. They knew what the other guy's number of killings was and what their number was. They'd sit in the bar and argue about who had done the most that day, who had the most killings, or in some cases, who had been involved in the most sexual assaults. In one example, a German administrator is walking into what's known as the Deutsches Haus, which would have been kind of a German community center as a way to think about it in the East, only for Germans. And he hears all this singing and all this activity going on in the bar as he's about to open the door. And as he opens the door, there's a Gestapo man coming outside. And the first thing he notices about that individual is he has a beer coaster on his blouse and his uniform tunic, and it has the number 1,000 inscribed in red. And the guy's kind of, well, what's going on? And what the individual tells him is he says, man, today I'm celebrating my 1,000th killing. The German term he used is Knickschuss, literally to shoot someone in the back of the head. And that this meeting around number, for example, is room for celebration. We also see this type of celebratory ritual in the T4, the so-called euthanasia program, in which now we have an SS sergeant who's celebrating the burning of his 20,000th corpse. We find the same type of activity at Treblinka upon the deportation of the 100,000th Jew from Warsaw to Treblinka during the mass killing in 1942, that the unit, the guard unit there at Treblinka, had a special party to celebrate the murder of the 100,000th victim. So again, we see this use of celebratory ritual included in the camps. We see it in the killing fields. We see it also in the ghettos, as I've talked about. And we see the way in which alcohol can be counterposed here with something like your 12th and 13th gassing that Johann Kramer, who's a doctor who's at Auschwitz, he has a very short diary entry. It's only about two or three sentences. And he talks about being a part of his 12th and 13th mass gassings. And then he ends his entry by talking about the Bulgarian red wine and the Croatian plum brandy that accompanied his dinner that evening. So just this matter of factness that's tied to that. We also see the use in the Action Reinhard, for example, camps, the widespread use of alcohol, these drunken parties on the part of both SS guards and on the part of the Trafnikis or those ethnic auxiliaries as well that are involved. And again, this is something where music's involved, as you can see, and the humiliation and dehumanization of those who are involved. Now, as I said, if we were to look at the standard historiography up to now about the use of alcohol, it mainly focuses on alcohol as a coping mechanism. And in fact, that is true, that alcohol was used for coping by some of the perpetrators. But as I tried to bring to mind here, or tried to demonstrate, that certainly that is one thing for some of the perpetrators, but that from the examples that I've given you a brief sampling from the book itself, that we see that that's by far not the only type of function of alcohol use. And I'm going to go ahead and this is really the last slide I want to speak to so that we have time for some discussion. But what's interesting to me about this topic is really it's a topic that's been hiding in plain sight, that the use of alcohol was ubiquitous, especially in the Nazi East. And when you really start looking for it, you start to find it in many, many accounts, both from the perpetrators, from the witnesses, and from the survivors themselves, that alcohol played a key role in creation of shared group identity and mission. That was certainly there, that camaraderie was a key part of this dynamic. But I think it's really critical to note that alcohol was neither necessary nor sufficient for killing. The Holocaust would have happened if there had not been any alcohol to drink. But the way it's used by the perpetrators is, I think, what really starts to give us the insights into this perpetrator mindset, whether it's celebration, the inclusion of song and music, acts of sexual violence, this idea of hunting as a competitive sport, if you will, and trophy counting is part of that. And I think it's also important that in some of the historiography, what we'll see is guys like Carl Jaeger, the notorious commander of EK, Einsatzkommando 3, and others talk about, you know, they have trouble sleeping. They had intestinal problems, stomach problems. And some historians have chosen to say, well, that's a function of their psychosomatic, they're reacting to what they're doing. And that's why they're having these problems. It's a psychological reaction. However, if you look at the literature, the medical literature on very heavy alcohol use, some of the very same issues happen with heavy alcohol use. So difficulty in sleeping, intestinal problems become another function manifestation of heavy alcohol use. And then the final bullet, as I have here, is I talked about multiple functions. So I think it's really important to understand that of those functions and multiple uses of alcohol, that they could be used sometimes together. They could, the same individual might use alcohol in different ways over the course of his time in the East or his time with the unit, based on what's happening in the war, based on what's happening in his life. And so I think that, again, that makes it somewhat difficult sometimes to kind of disentangle, if you will. And this is a photo I like to end all my discussions with. It comes from my police book. And the reason I do that is because I can talk about theories of masculinity and alcohol use. But I think what's really important for us to remember, again, is this is my 6 million in 1 and 6 million in 2. This is a photograph of a security serviceman with a police unit, policeman in the back, and they've come across this young woman and this boy, you see in the tattered clothing in the forest. And I don't know what her and his fate were, but what I can tell you is that in many cases, a young woman and a young boy there who are in the caught in the woods, who don't have papers, this is the last, literally the last moments of their life being interrogated and then subsequently murdered as quote unquote partisans or because they were Jews. And so I just think that that's an important thing as we talk academically about this topic, to remember the emotion and kind of the human factor that's associated. So on that note, I told Thorin that I didn't want to go past 45 minutes in order to have some discussion. So I would welcome your questions or comments in the last 15 minutes that we have.
Thanks so much, Professor Westerman. That was really a super presentation and did so much to capture what's in your book. There's a lot more there, and I'm going to prompt you on a few of those things. But yet I think you did such a nice job of really capturing the meat of what's in your book. And I just want to highlight this. You know, when I started reading your book and I saw it and I thought, alcohol and the Holocaust, that seems like a well-trodden topic. And yet you take us to a whole different view of it. And it's not just kind of Nazis kind of sitting in the corner drinking to make up for what they, or to get over what they've just done. You really do highlight that the alcohol came in different ways into their lives. And you've got Himmler saying, you know, we shouldn't be drinking at all, or we should really just limit it. And then you've got other guys who are saying this is just celebratory, having a great time. And that includes this horrendous murder. And I got to tell you, I really found your book hard to get through at times, because as you've done here, it's not just about alcohol. You talk about the victims, and you give us really some deeply, deeply troubling stories about what that alcohol enabled people to do and what the Nazis did. And in some ways, I took away from the book, it brings in all these examples that you just don't want to read. But when you're looking for examples of the horrors of the Holocaust, you really have shown it to us here. And I valued it greatly. So I want to encourage others. Some people have put in some questions, and so we'll get to those. But if you have other questions, please use the Q&A function. If I could just, there's a quote I wanted to read to you and get your feedback on it, because I found this such a tough book at times. And you write at the end of your book, "In the study of Nazi Germany, it is perhaps a blessing and a curse today that today's reader may find much of what is discussed in this book too hard to read or too difficult to believe." And I just wanted you to talk a little about that and ask you what you meant and why you thought it was important to put in the details that you have.
Yeah, and Thorne, I appreciate that question, because Zev Weiss, who was the president of the Holocaust Educational Foundation, who passed away last year, and a survivor of Auschwitz and the Hungarian deportations, was a very good friend of mine. And one of the things I always remember at the conferences that the Holocaust Educational Foundation would host was, if a historian said, you know, for us to understand this, and Zev would always say, stand up and say, no, your historians, your political scientists, your language and literature people, you can't understand the Holocaust. And I knew what he meant. Intellectually. And what I saw in thinking about that, and that's always stuck with me over the years, that in looking at this story, one of the things that prevents us from understanding is because most of us are not, don't have that frame of mind that's conditioned over time, in which that process of dehumanization of the other took place. And then when you start to see these examples and you see them in real life, what they meant, it's hard for the normal person to say, oh yeah, but in fact, those were normal people who committed many of these acts, right? And what we really learn in looking at this, as horrific as it is that it really gives us an insight into some of the reality of the Holocaust that we don't always want to think about, because it makes us uncomfortable. It exposes this absolute corruption in human nature. And it taints us, it seems like, sometimes in a way from knowing about it, like the things that you can't unread or unsee. But I think what it does is, I think about Zev's words to me, was it also gives us a better understanding of what he meant by that. Because the things that we can't imagine were daily life for those who experienced the Holocaust. And in that respect, Vasily Grossman, who I quote in the book as well, reacted very much the same way in writing about this. When people ask him, why are you writing about these terrible things at Treblinka? And he said, because I owe it to the survivors. I owe it to the killed, those who were murdered, to provide these stories. And I truly believe that as difficult a book as it is, that is an important, that is an important element of the book.
Thank you. Let me get to one of the questions that was posed here. Greta Kraus asks, do you know if the Nazis tried to recruit men who had violent and or aggressive tendencies, or did the atmosphere of the Nazis that the Nazis created just support violence and aggression?
Yeah, that's a really good question too. And it kind of gets us back to some of this nature versus nurture. But what's really interesting as perpetrators, especially after the war, H.V. Dix and others interviewed. We know with Franz Stangl's interview, we know that, as I talked about, Rudolf Höss gets interviewed about, why did you do the things you did? And psychologists are trying to kind of figure out, why are these men like they are? And one of the suppositions had been, well, they all really have to be sadists, right? That's the explanation. They're abnormal monsters, right? And this is where Chris Browning's work really kind of intersects back, that the idea of ordinary men, no, they weren't abnormal mentally in those terms. They weren't, psychopaths, really. Now, there are some who obviously are part and parcel of this, but the vast majority are not. So those committing these acts are men who are just like normal German men would have been in the period. So as the questioner asked, the conditioning is really a key part, is a key part of this, and the expectations of the group. And that's where, like I said, these perceptions of masculinity and perceptions where you also see, as a specific example, men who came back from these killing actions. If there was going to be a celebratory ritual, if there was going to be drinking after the event, what many of them talk about was you could not participate, because saying, hey, I don't want to drink tonight, or I just don't want to drink, was not seen as saying, hey, okay, you just don't want to have a drink with us tonight. It was seen as rejecting first the group and by extension what the group had been involved in. And so you see again how, in this case, elements of peer pressure, but perceptions of toughness, masculinity, how that starts to condition individuals to become involved in these kinds of actions. So I think that that's an extremely important part of this, is the way that individuals are socialized into these actions. And I think it's also important to say that not every person could do it immediately. There's an acclimation that takes place over time for many of the perpetrators. In some cases, that might be a day or a week. It might be, as in one case I talk about it in the book, a guy who starts, he writes his wife, says, hey, they only gave me 28 bullets. I think I'm going to have a lot to do. I'll have some, quote, pretty things to tell you after this is all over. And then his next letter, 10 days later, to his wife, he's talking about this mass execution he was involved in. And he tells her, well, you know, the first group, my hands were trembling. By the 10th group that came up, he goes, I didn't have any problems in shooting men, women, and children. And he talks about being involved in a competition where they're throwing children and shooting them out of the air. So between the first and the 10th group, this individual, and this is what he's sharing with his wife. And that's not necessarily a function of alcohol. I don't know if alcohol was involved in that, but we see again that kind of mindset, if you will. And this is a normal, quote unquote, individual who becomes involved in that type of activity.
Yeah, you know, I always think it would be easier and nicer to believe that the horrors of the Nazis were committed by monsters. And the kind of more troubling aspect is that they were not monsters. They were us, and that we, or I, have the potential to do these kinds of behaviors under certain circumstances. And that's much more troubling, I think. Can I just, I know there's another question I want to get to, but let me just raise this one. My colleague asked me to ask this one, which is about, you talk a lot about alcohol, but what about drug use? How big a deal? What were there drugs that were being used in the same way? Was that a big part of serving in the military and being in the Einsatzgruppen and working in the camps?
Yeah, that's again another really excellent question. And some of your viewers will be familiar with Norman Ohler's book, the journalist Norman Ohler's book, the English language version is Blitzed, where he talks about the use of Pervitin by German forces, especially by German military, and how it's methamphetamine, and how, in fact, in his mind, that those drugs were what explains these guys who are hyped up on meth essentially becoming these kind of killer machines that that can stay awake and that have no kind of, are able to sublimate all of their kind of cognitive functions to just being killers, if you will. And what's really interesting in my work is that Himmler talks about all kinds of stuff. One of the things, he keeps his pulse on these units, or tries to, with respect to paperwork. He'll talk about cases of venereal disease. He wants to approve every marriage application from every SS man, wants to personally see it. He talks about alcohol a great deal. And one of the things that Himmler does with respect to people who abuse alcohol is he makes them take an oath not to drink for a year or for 3 years. And so he does that, and you'll see all these discussions of alcohol. Never once did I come across a document where Himmler talks about the use of Pervitin or the use of drugs amongst SS and police forces. And for me, this is the old Sherlock Holmes, the dog that didn't bark, right? It's the absence of that evidence, right? The absence that's there when he is so involved in so many other aspects of the SS and police forces, that is not discussed. So from my own research, I never came across a reference to Pervitin amongst SS and policemen, for example, their use of methamphetamine. And I do think it's important to note that we have to be really, really careful with cause and effect here, because I think, as some of the reviewers of Ohler's book talked about, that it appears that you give the perpetrators kind of a free pass in terms of, if they're drugged up to their eyeballs, of course they might do these kinds of crazy things, right? And that's why I'm very careful to say that alcohol was neither necessary nor sufficient. You know, these acts would have happened without it.
And you say at the end of your book, I know you talk about how alcohol was used by some in the trials at the end of the war to kind of justify the that was done by the drunk folks, the alcoholics, but most Germans were good and was, yeah, kind of switched around.
Yeah. So what happens is, even during the war, Volltrunkenheit, so which would translate to be completely wasted, completely drunk, can be seen as a mitigating factor for things like sexual violence, unauthorized killing. So the German courts and the German SS and police courts recognize that as a mitigating factor in sentencing. Well, after World War II, extreme alcohol use or drunkenness is used by many of those who are being interviewed to say, well, we were all drunk, or that these individuals who I saw were drinking, because it could then be used as a mitigating factor in their sentencing if they're convicted. And it makes sense that alcohol kind of becomes an alibi, because for us who are reading, you know, as historians, when I was reading that testimony, Thorin, you or I reading that testimony, or our viewers would go, oh, yeah, that makes sense. You couldn't do it otherwise. Yeah, there's no way you could do those kinds of things if you weren't drinking. But I think what we also have to think about, many of your viewers, especially in New York, since Mad Men is was stationed, you know, was set in New York, right? If anybody watched Mad Men, you saw, you know, the 10 o'clock bourbon or scotch drinking, lunchtime martinis drinking in the afternoon. And today we watch that through the eyes of the 21st century and say, those guys are a bunch of drunks. But in the 1940s and 1950s, right, alcohol usage like that is not perceived, right? So we've created a new frame of reference for heavy drinking. And I think that's important to recognize, because Pete Hamill, a New York reporter and writer, in his book A Drinking Life, talks about the working class neighborhoods of New York in the 1940s. And he talks about those bars in those neighborhoods. And those are male enclaves. Women are not allowed in. If the women are allowed in, it's in the back room. And the women probably then are have a kind of sketchy reputation, quote unquote. And how are you judged against your male counterparts? By your ability to drink and your ability to use your fists, right? And so I think in some respects, what we call heavy drinking today, we kind of fail to remember how alcohol would fit in a social and cultural placement in the 1940s or even 1950s.
I know we need to wrap up, but I want to get to Felice's question here. She asks about if there were studies done about Nazi soldiers or police who, well after the war, in the 1950s, 60s, or 70s, who looked back and said, wow, I can't believe I did those terrible things. Is that the case? Are there studies of Nazi veterans?
Yeah, not really. And what's really interesting to me, and Felice, this is a great question, because one of the things when I looked at the police in my first book, what you find is that the way these investigations start with the prosecutors after the war is almost never by a policeman coming back and saying, you know, I can't live with myself for what I was involved in. I've got to tell somebody. What you'll often see is that the spouse of a policeman who's been subsequently abused or is breaking up with her husband will go to the prosecutors and say, let me tell you about this guy. And let me tell you about what he and his buddies talked about that they were involved in World War II. And I know we're short on time, but one of the interesting things to me, and this is why I want to bring this up, is I'd be very interested. There's no study on domestic violence in the Third Reich, and there's no study that tracks how these men continued to use alcohol, and especially with respect to things like domestic violence in the 1950s or 1960s, which I think would be a fascinating study to bring forward. So great question again, I wish I had a better answer for you.
I know we need to wrap up. I just wanted to make an editorial comment and say, I think your book is really super as an example of where history has gone. And the way you integrate, you talked about it at the beginning of your presentation, that social science research, and you bring in the different perspectives. And I'm thinking particularly about gender history and sexual violence, which, you know, for a long time, that was something separate. And there were books about sexual violence, but you've done such a great job here, I think, weaving that in and making it part of the story. And anyway, I just wanted to put that in and say how impressed I was with it. So, thank you very much, Professor Westerman. I thank all of you out there for watching us. And I look forward to seeing you, the population, at other programs. And Professor Westerman, I look forward to reading your next book and staying in touch. So thanks so much.
Thanks so much, everybody. Thanks, Thorin. Have a good evening.
Have a good night, everybody.